Hello, Claudette. Good evening. How was your day?
It was very eventful, thank you. And yours?
It was very good, thank you. I had a lot of work to do, but it was fun work.
That's always good.
Yes. How was lunch yesterday?
Lunch. Oh, very good. You were the only one missing of our group. And so hopefully we're going to do it at my house every Tuesday if you can make it.
Thank you for that. I'll plan on it. I didn't realize it was a thing. I like to be a part of that.
Yeah, it's a weekly grouping for anyone who that time fits for them that have been to Casillo. And do you have a Casillo card, one of the Rule of Life cards?
I'm sure I do somewhere. Betty's been a we'll talk offline.
Okay.
All righty.
Is that Nina?
It is.
Hi,
Hey, Betty.
how are things going?
Pretty good. Brian's home. We got home actually this afternoon, but I'm having to play nurse. But he's got some stuff that he's got to work through for his because of his surgery. But the
Yeah.
biggest thing is that we have to Hi, Jeremy. We have to wait for the results from his biopsies,
Yeah.
which might be next Monday or Tuesday.
We're praying for him.
Thank you. Thank you. Hey, Paula.
Hello.
But you're not there in person either, huh?
No, I was feeling funky today, so I
Oh.
decided to stay home.
Oh.
But I wanted to be there anyhow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Same doors
Thank you.
I've got.
Well, Betty, did you go to the daughter's Eucharistic celebration today?
Yes, I did. It was lovely.
Oh.
Father Jeremy just was
All
really
right.
right on board as always, that his words were very specific and endearing and helpful and just was very good.
Oh, good. I prayed for y'all. We were getting ready to go h come home, and I was praying for you. I knew it was going on. I'm sorry
Yeah,
I
we
missed
had a
you.
nice group. There were probably, let's see, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine or so of us. Eight or nine of us.
Good. Good. Well, I guess we better shut off our mics, huh? Otherwise, we're going to be told to shut up, huh?
Yeah, we
Well,
hear everything you say.
oh gosh. All right,
Absolutely not.
I'm shutting it off. Hey, David. Somebody's going to have to take
Yeah, I'll take a
role
sip.
there since I'm not there.
What's that, Duncan? Yeah. I don't have a pen up here, though.
Duncan will take role.
Hi, David. This is the first time I've seen you, and Laurie says you're always there.
I'm always there, and I usually do it like this.
Yeah,
Yeah.
I see
Well,
his name up there a lot.
I've done it
You're.
like that the last couple of weeks.
Yeah.
We just put it next. Yeah,
All
I'll
right.
check
I'm gonna
that.
mute.
Claudette, I'm gonna put David. Paul in the middle there.
Hey, Felix. Hey, Janice. Is that Rich William? Janice Roberts?
Oh, I just made him something.
I think Janice David's in just spelled it.
Yeah. All right, my friend. Getting started up here. What's up, Felix?
What's up, man? Oh, I missed. You're really your vision. It's the Roman. Like the Legionnaires or something. Yeah.
No, it's like my wooden fake hand now. Right. Well, I am. Well, here's your reminder if you're at home to hit mute if you haven't yet until you're ready to make a comment or whatever. That way we don't hear you sneeze or yell something across the house at your spouse or whatever. And here comes Colette. It's good. Yeah, we got a lot of people staying home tonight, but we got some people that showed up here. It's good. All right, we're going to be ambitious tonight, everyone. We're going to finish the last one and get in the next one. The next one really isn't that much text to work through compared to the others. You know, the fifth vision is just those two chapters. So we're going to try and crank through all of it and get sort of caught up, okay? It's going to take some doing, but I think we should be able to do it. We really worked through last time all the sort of time-consuming stuff, I feel, in that last one already. So we'll finish up that the vision, the fourth vision, right? The dragon, or the first portrait of the first woman, anyway, the church, right? Yeah, maybe in my in future versions of this class when I teach it again in a few years or whatever, I'll change it to, first and second woman or, two women instead of focusing on the dragon so much. Because the dragon really gets his, he gets his due in this one and also in the one with Babylon. So, all right, well, let's start with prayer and then we'll jump in. Heavenly Father, as we now turn to your word, first we thank you for it. And as we were just discussing in evening prayer, Lord, we pray that you will give us eyes to see and ears to hear. And having eyes that we would look, having ears that we would listen closely and attentively, because your word is life. And you've given us this revelation, this book and all the Bible, that we might understand you and your ways, we might know you and love you and even be warned from the wrath to come. So Lord, save us from it and save us for yourself, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right, so jumping in, I'm going to grab my Bible here. We left off with looking at the second beast. Get my Bible open here. And we're getting now down, this is on the latter parts of chapter 13. And do you remember what we discussed as the identities of the beasts, the dragon, and then the two beasts? What did I say was the first beast in my reading anyway? You don't have to agree with me, but yeah, I think it is corrupt governments, and all governments are corrupt to one degree or another, but especially corrupt ones. I think this fits the bill. And then what was the second beast representing? Yeah, religion, philosophy, sort of the influencers, right? Isn't that crazy now that influencers are, it's like an industry? It's really, I don't know, it's crazy. There's some good and bad and all that, but it's just how people can have that as a profession now is something else. What's your job? Well, I'm influential. and I try to convince people of my point of view. I mean, let's be honest, that's how most of us spend our days anyway. We just don't get paid for it. Anyway, but I'm here all week, people. All right, so let's get now into the latter bits here. And we see that, just as we saw before, that those who belong to the Lamb, well, we'll see this, the beginning of 14. If you cheat and you look ahead, you see in 14:1 that there's the 144,000, which represents the perfection, the totality of the church. And they had his name, the Lamb's name, and the Father's name written on their foreheads. Remember, we've looked at that before. And here, back in the end of 13, and we see in 16, it causes all, both small and great, both rich and poor, both free and slave, to be marked on the right hand of the forehead, so that no one can buy or sell unless he has the mark, that is the name of the beast or the number of its name. Now, what are some interesting interpretations of this that you've heard? Because people will talk, oh, it's the mark of the beast. I'm not going to do that. Have you heard anybody mention that or in relation to current events? What was that, Joda? Yeah. Scanners, like little barcodes or whatever. You know, we all do it to our dogs now. You put the mark of the beast on your beast. I mean, not, I don't think that is the mark of the beast, but and it could be related. But, you know, they'll say, you know, microchips or whatever. And, yeah, and as our society gets into getting the beginning stages of what's going on in China right now, which is social ranking of people, and people now can be locked out literally from buying or selling. You can't even ride the train or get on an airplane in China now if you don't have a high enough social standing, social ranking, according to the government metrics. Isn't that crazy? It is, yeah. And so, you know, you see where, like, people will try to go to the store and buy food, and they're like, sorry, you're not authorized. Like, how do these people live? You know what I mean? And now a lot of people think we're in the beginning stages of that, even here in the West. I just listened to a podcast the other day, and they're talking about if you've used Uber before, you have an Uber ranking. How many stars, right? And so all these different things, which are relatively harmless in and of themselves, if somebody puts them in a big database and starts ranking people according to how socially agreeable they are, you can end people's lives and their livelihoods in just a matter of seconds, you know? And that's neither here nor there. That's going to make us go long if I keep doing this kind of thing. But I don't know. It's like but I don't think it's really a microchip or like a barcode or something. Or a retina scan or something like that, you know, this way to fingerprint to yourself. Maybe it's a DNA scan or whatever. But it is, I think it is the corollary. I think we were getting into this a little bit last time, where those who belong to the Lamb are marked with his name. They're sort of branded in a spiritual way. And remember when we talked about that was before, the seal of the Holy Spirit. Remember that? That's the presence, it's a tag of ownership. We belong to him. And those who don't belong to him have the mark, not of the Lamb, but of the beast. And so this is a spiritual thing. It's like your spiritual citizenship or passport or something. But it's an intangible thing. It's a spiritual thing. And then as we saw, if you don't have the mark of the beast, that is, if you don't belong to the world and the prince of the power of the air and all the dark forces that are in it, you won't even be able to. I do think this is literal. You can't buy or sell unless you have the mark. I think there's a lot of economic stuff buried in Revelation. Maybe I think that I find that convincing. These are very symbolic and metaphysical seeming, but I think the real world applications will be much more familiar to us if we could see them unveiled, you know. But I do think literally there are going to be economic consequences, as we've already looked at before. That's why we can't buy or sell. And I find it interesting too, as I was thinking about this mark of the beast on the right hand or the forehead. Does that remind you of anything from the Bible? Yeah, the Jewish phylacteries, and then they bind themselves with straps, and then they have a phylactery on their offhand. So if you're right-handed, it's on your left, or vice versa. And so this is like a Jewish mark of identity. And I don't know that they did that in the first century. So I haven't dug that deep in my research, but I just saw this because there's a guy I know from our time in England. He's a Jewish guy. And, you know, they're really having a hard time right now with what's going on in Israel and in Gaza. And there's a lot of contention about who's pro-Israel and who's pro-Hamas and all this. Yeah. And so he's really reacting strongly. And so he had his, I never thought of him as a particularly religious guy, but he had his phylacteries on, and he had his arms all bound up, and he's just, you know, he's like, we're here and we're in this, and, you know, we're going to stay strong, kind of a thing. But it was such a dramatic image to see the straps wrapped around his arms and, you know, and on his forehead and everything. And I find it interesting that the mark of the beast is between the eyes and on one of the arms. You know, so it's like there's ways of marking people. And this is why, this is what was said to Moses and to Israel through Moses. It shall be to you as a sign, the word of God, this promise, this covenant, right? Shall be to you as a sign on your hand and as a memorial between your eyes, that the law of the Lord may be in your mouth. For with a strong hand, the Lord has brought you out of Egypt. So I thought that was a really interesting parallel. Let's see, I'm going to get it. Some people on Zoom are just come in, but they haven't muted their thing yet. So if you could mute your Zoom. All right. 666. That's the number of the beast, right? Actually, I've not heard anything that sounds terribly convincing about why that's the number of the beast and what that number means. All kinds of different theories floating around. One that I thought was interesting was, you know, if the number of perfection is 7666 would be just like falling short, like wanting it, thinking you're perfect, thinking you're the end all and be all, but falling short. I thought that was interesting. Another one that's not quite as interesting is if you take the Greek word for beast, which is therion, the Greek language doesn't have numbers, or at least it didn't have numbers like we do. You know, we have our characters, and then we've imported in Arabic numerals or whatever, right? They used letters as numbers. A lot of languages do this. And so if you turn the word in Greek for beast and you read it like a number, it's 666. So maybe it's like shorthand or something, like an abbreviation for his name, you know, the name of the beast. So it maybe, you know, so if the Christians have what was on Aaron's forehead, which is holy unto the Lord, maybe they've got beast written across their forehead. It's sort of a brand and a mark, you know. I don't know. So, you know, it's a spiritual thing. And so it really is, though, a sign of ownership either way, who belongs to who. And so people who think they're walking around, I'm my own man, or I'm my own woman, you know. I'm not evil. I don't belong to Satan, but I don't belong to God either. Guess what? They belong to evil. That's part of the deception that has been, that they think they're independent and free, but they're not, because there's only freedom found in Christ. Anybody on this planet, spiritual freedom is only found in him. Okay, moving on into 14, we see the 144,000 as first fruits. And, you know, it just we need to remember, because we've already looked at this, that this represents the complete fullness of the people of God. And first fruits is the promise, is that the promised remnant would be preserved. And we've got passages in Isaiah 10, Jeremiah 23, and Micah 2, and Zechariah 8 that go along with this remnant in the first fruits of Israel, meaning the people of God. So it's Isaiah 10, verses 20 to 23. Jeremiah 23, Micah 2, 12 to 13, and then Zechariah 8. And they're singing and they're following the Lamb wherever he goes. That's a great, I've heard people preach on that one line before. They follow the Lamb wherever he goes. That's a great description of a Christian. And the redeemed for mankind is first fruits for God and the Lamb. And then we've got the three angels. It seems to me that so the first angel in verse 6, he has an eternal gospel to proclaim to those who dwell on the earth, to every nation and tribe and language and people. And he says with a loud voice, fear God and give him glory, because the hour of his judgment has come. Worship him who made heaven and earth, the sea and the springs of water. And then another one comes and says, fallen, fallen is Babylon the Great. And then another one says, if anyone worships the beast in his image and receives a mark on his forehead or on his hand, he will also will drink the wine of God's wrath, poured full strength into the cup of his anger. He'll be tormented with fire and sulfur, etc. When I hear this, I kind of think that's what the two witnesses back in chapter 11 were preaching. And it seems to me that these three angels are three different kinds of proclamations that the church makes. So my wondering is if these angels don't represent the ministry of the church. Any thoughts on that? Then you get this key line here in verse 12. I have this sort of boxed and starred in my Bible. Here is a call for the endurance of the saints, those who keep the commandments of God and their faith in Jesus Christ. I think that's the big refrain, not only through this section, but I think that goes over the whole book of Revelation too. Yeah, there's, you know, Jesus conquers and we're more than conquerors in him and all. I think that's true too. But I think a large part of the pastoral reason for giving the book of Revelation is found in those two little phrases. Here is a call for the endurance of the saints. You know, hang in there, stick it out, keep going, don't give up. And then this last line is a common one for funerals. Write this, blessed are those who die in the Lord from now on. Blessed indeed, says the Spirit, that they may rest from their labors, for their deeds follow them. And then here in verse 14 to the end, we get into the final harvest and destruction, I've called it here. Now, really, there are two moments of harvesting, aren't there? So one is a white cloud and a seat on the cloud, one like a son of man. Who should you think of when you hear the title son of man? You should usually understand it's usually referring to Jesus, not always, but usually. That should be the first thing you suspect if you investigate more. And the artist of this book that I've got has cast Jesus as someone with a sickle ready to harvest. And then you've got an angel that comes with another sickle. And they call out, put in your sickle and gather the clusters from the vines of the earth, for its grapes are ripe. So you get the grapes of wrath, yeah? And so if this is a depiction of the final judgment, and so is this like a two-stage judgment where the first, the Son of Man, sort of harvests a bunch and then the angel comes along and harvests some more and that's just everybody's cut down? Is that what it's referring to? Maybe, but I tend to think it's not just two angels doing it, but I think it's first Christ harvesting the church and gathering the church in. So he cuts us free of the world and he gathers us into himself. He sort of sticks us in his barn in heaven. it's a harvest where you're gathering things that are precious to you, right? And then the second one is tramping the grapes, you know. So, for example, in Matthew 2, John the Baptist, he prophesies about the wheat and the chaff. Matthew 2, verse 12. And then Jesus in John 4 says, "Do you not say there are yet 4 months, then comes the harvest? Look, I tell you, lift up your eyes and see that the fields are white with harvest." Someone who wants to reap it, right? He says it's ready, you know. Matthew 13, I just preached on this, I think, earlier this year. We got the wheat and the tares. So, you know, they say, "Oh, should we pull out the tares?" He says, "No, you'll hurt the wheat, you know. Harvest the wheat, and then we'll burn the tares." And so in Isaiah 63, you get a gripping presentation of the grapes being trampled, just like in here in Revelation. In Isaiah 63, it's a very well known. We read this. I usually have us read this in Holy Week on Good Friday. "Who is this who comes?" This is Isaiah 63, verse 1. "Who is this who comes from Edom in crimson garments from Bozrah, who is splendid in his apparel, marching in the greatness of his strength? It is I, speaking in righteousness, mighty to save." Well, so it's like a dialogue back and forth between the Lord and then maybe the angels. There's people who are calling out to him. "Why is your apparel red and your garments like his who treads in the winepress? So why are your clothes stained with red?" And he says, "I have trodden the winepress alone. From the peoples, no one was with me. I trod them in my anger and trampled them in my wrath. Their lifeblood spattered on my garments and stained all my apparel. For the day of vengeance was in my heart and my year of redemption had come. I looked, but there was no one to help. I was appalled, but there was no one to uphold. So my own arm brought me salvation, and my wrath upheld me. I trampled down the peoples in my anger. I made them drunk in my wrath. I poured out their lifeblood on the earth." That's stern and sobering stuff, isn't it? We like to think of little baby Jesus, meek and mild. But those little feet that, like, Joseph and Mary would tickle, you know, you can imagine, like, the wise men, you know, coochie-coo, kind of, you know, with the baby, right? Those same feet are going to tread on the peoples of the earth that belong to the beast and continue in rebellion against him. He is an uncompromising ruler. He's an uncompromising king. And justice will come. You get this trampling of the grapes image in Joel chapter 3 as well. And notice how complete the flow is. You've got... the flow of blood goes out. And it is, you know, 1,600 stadia, or 184 miles. And so if you break down 1,600, it's 4 by 4 by 1,000. So that's like the four corners of the earth times 1,000 for completeness, right? For the age and duration of all time. And so the blood goes for 184 miles symbolically, and the blood is as deep as a horse's bridle. You know, it's about as tall as me. And so this would seem to be all the lifeblood of the earth. So he gathers up those that are his, and then the rest are trampled and destroyed that are left over. As I was just saying in evening prayer, this is life and death business. Christianity and sin and all that, we kind of think, well, you know, it's if it worked, if you, you know, you can be a little better, it's fine and all that. Who we belong to has eternal consequences. There's no other way to put it. And Revelation is confronting us with this reality. Do I belong to Christ? Do I have his mark? Or do I have the other? I mean, do you feel the weight of this when you read this? And the absoluteness of it? There's no escape. There's no escape. There's no Switzerland, you know, you can run to and hide out. This is black and white, either or. And it's very sobering and very stern and very real. So that concludes us for that vision. And so this one really is it's about the whole scope of things, but you know, it starts off with the woman and then the fall of Satan and the beasts. Any thoughts or reflections on that before we move on? Yeah. Okay. All right, let's move into chapter 15 now. And the fifth vision, the seven bowls of wrath. So again, we're in the second half of the book of Revelation, which began with chapter 12. And in those first 11 chapters, you know, we've left behind the visions of seven, you know, seven churches and seven seals and seven trumpets and all that. And now we've got these two portraits of these women. We've got the church and we've got Babylon, the church and the world. And in between those two visions of those two women, we have here another seven, which is the seven bowls of the wrath of God. Now, this one is a depiction of the final judgment. It doesn't get into any warning stuff or anything like that. It just goes straight to the end. And so this is, if you're putting your transparency sheet over the other ones, it only has, like, in the timeline kind of a sense, only part of it is marked. You know what I mean? So it goes, this lays over the end and fills out all the stuff. Because before, the other visions have just been alluding or sort of foreshadowing this, right? Then we saw the ark and of heaven. The heaven was open. And we saw the ark and there was thunder and lightning and all this, right? But it didn't tell us what happened or anything like that. This one is just unpacking, just slowing down, zooming in on what happens at the end. And it's not going to be the only time we do this, but this is more detail than we've ever gotten before to this point. And so it jumps right in. And it starts off with this. Well, here it is. Then I saw another sign in heaven. So it would seem to be sequential, 15:1. A great and amazing, you know, sign, a vision. Seven angels, seven plagues, which are the last. For with them the wrath of God is finished. So, you know, that's just straight up what it says. This is a depiction of the fullness of the wrath of God. And what we get here, but then he goes from there, he goes to this, he sort of, the camera cuts, and then we see a scene of the saints in heaven. And they're on the other side of the sea. They've conquered the beast, and if they're successful, they've been delivered from it. They're standing beside the sea with harps in their hands, and they're singing the song of Moses. Now, there's your clue. What does this image remind you of? What's that? Yeah, the escape from Egypt, the Exodus. Right? It's the same scene functionally, where they've been set free from their enemies. They've been delivered from slavery and from the pursuing hordes that are trying to destroy them, right? And there's a sea standing between them in danger, and their enemies are completely destroyed. And then Moses and you know, Aaron and Miriam were leading the song, you know, and the song of Moses. And it's just a song of praise to God for his deliverance. And the horse and rider is thrown into the sea and just praising his name. So they're singing this song. And so here they're singing that song, it seems. And then they add some more singing, some more words. And it's like it summarizes. It seems that Moses wrote another song in Deuteronomy 32. The book Deuteronomy means a second law. It's like the second giving of the law, a Deuteronomos. And he gives them another song there. And this one sounds a bit like it. And then there's the different aspects of that song Moses sang in Deuteronomy echo throughout the rest of Israel's life and history, especially in the prophets will pick up echoes and themes from Moses' song in Deuteronomy 32. And so I think they're really singing the song of Moses from the Exodus, and also this extra song of just lots of Moses singing going on. These songs that Moses gave the people of God, or God gave them through Moses, right? Now, again, we could be cynical and say, well, John wasn't very original here. He's just sort of ripping off what Moses did. We can look at it that way in sort of a historical, critical kind of a view, as in John's not very original. Or we can look at it in the way that I've been arguing, that rather God gave them this song way back in the Exodus, thousands of years before these events will happen, so that they would have a familiar song to sing and understand the fullness of it when they finally get there, right? So it's like the Exodus out of Egypt and all the plagues and all that were like a trial run for the end. Does that make sense? Sort of a miniature version foreshadowing the reality to come. Remember my analogy of the little Lego cathedral inside the big real cathedral? This is like the Exodus, as great and powerful as that was out of Egypt, was like the little mini model of the reality that it was foreshadowing and pointing to. Just like Noah and the flood of the earth, same thing. I mean, think about it. I've told you all this before, but you know, the earth is completely, it's judged and completely destroyed. And the only people that are saved are those who are related to family members of the only one man of faith on the whole earth. It's a really suggestive image, isn't it? There's only been one, truly one real man of faith in the whole earth who completely put his trust in God, and that is Jesus Christ. And so the image, it maps over very nicely when you realize that only those who are related to Jesus Christ, right, through adoption, right, and through union with him, are children of God. They're under Christ, our elder brother. And those are the ones who are saved from the wrath to come. It's the same thing here. And it's the same image with Moses and the plagues in Egypt and all that. And this is all getting us ready. These are all giving us different ways to see and understand word pictures of the end. This is the reality. We tend to think of Revelation as more symbolic and shadowy. Actually, Noah and the flood, or Moses and the Israelites coming out of Egypt with the plagues and all this, those were shadowy. This is the reality. Is that, are you hanging? I don't want to be like, because I can go with this stuff and I get out there sometimes, but this is what it's doing. It's like Paul says in 1 Corinthians 10, when I just talked about this in a sermon a few weeks ago, these things happened to them as an example, but they were written down for our instruction, whom the end of the ages has come. So we're to learn from these things that happened in the past that God orchestrated and recorded and had passed down to us and now read in church, right? So that we would be prepared and have, one of my teachers used to call all these stories in scripture like a thesaurus. So that we have synonyms and ways to, oh, I get, this is like that, right? That, how do we learn words when we're kids? You learn a new word, you say, well, this is kind of like that word. And it means this. And they're like, oh, okay, I get it now, right? That's how the Word of God works. It's a thesaurus, which just means a treasure house. It's a treasury of words. That's what a thesaurus is. It's not a dinosaur. It's a treasury of images and words. And the Word of God is the same thing. It gives us the tools and the concepts with which to understand what goes on. So we have a grid and a framework and a grammar to speak when we're talking about what God's going to do in the end when it finally does come to pass. Does that make sense? Yeah. So there they are. And then the church is on the other side of the sea, and the wrath begins. So it's hard for me to know if they've been brought out of the wrath, and they're sort of safe from it before it all happens, or do they go through it and they're just rejoicing on the other side? Is that question, am I clear in that? So in the way that's written here, we see them on the seashore rejoicing and praising God. But then as you keep reading, then the wrath comes. So is this in order sequentially, I wonder? Or is this a flash forward to see that the church is safe in the end after the wrath has come? And then we go through all the wrath. Does that make sense? So one has to do with, is this a timeline? Other is just a literary rearrangement of things. I wonder if you look at verse 16, 15, after all the six bowls have been emptied out, this is in parentheses in mind. This is like Jesus putting in an editorial comment. Behold, I'm coming like a thief, right? Remember Jesus even talked about this. I'll be like a thief in the night when I come. And so it's like believers and unbelievers need to be ready for him when he finally comes, right? And so I tend to think that the church will go through six of the seven bowls of God's wrath. Because of the way he says here, I'm coming like a thief. And so Jesus comes, and then the seventh bowl comes. So I could be wrong about that, but that's how I'm tempted to read it. I want to say, no, the church doesn't go through any of the bowls. Yeah, that sounds really nice, doesn't it? And I'm like thinking that, I even have my notes, and then I read that, and I'm like, crud, I got to go edit all that out now. So I think like a thief. And then I was like, can't you come like a thief in the night before bowl one? Why didn't you put that earlier? You know? But hey, you know, so if he comes and then he takes us to himself, this is going to be part of my big timeline at the end. We don't experience the seventh bowl, the final destruction of everything. Yeah. So my reading right here, right now, is that the church only escapes the final. But I could be wrong. I hope I am. That doesn't sound fun. But notice too, going back now to the sea of glass, it has fire in it. Isn't that interesting? And I wonder if the fire represents sort of the wrath of God falling on the tyrant and his forces. You know, Pharaoh and his armies pursuing the Israelites is one of the best images to understand Satan and his dark angels pursuing the church. Again, that's an image that's provided for us through what God did in ancient times to teach us about spiritual realities. You know, Pharaoh and his armies trying to chase him down. And then what happens? The sea closes in over them, right? And so pretty soon, the Israelites are just standing on the other side. And there's all these like dead bodies bobbing up, you know, and it's just completely gone. One minute, there's the shout of war and they're terrified. And the next minute, there's a roar of waters. And then there's silence. And they look around, they're like, are you okay? We made it. We made it. You know, they can't believe it. And then they just burst out in song. It's like this big party, you know? And they're shouting and jumping and laughing and dancing. And Miriam's up there, you know, kicking her heels and all that. It's a dramatic scene. And this is the scene that we're meant to see what it's going to be like after we escape the final wrath. And we're gonna just be so delighted and thrilled that he rescued us, you know? That he rescued us. But you know, we've got to, this is a literal thing that's happening. John the Baptist in Matthew 3, when he sees the Pharisees and Sadducees coming to his coming to receive baptism, or at least to hear him, he gives them this snarky remark. And John the Baptist just had this wicked sarcasm, and he had a biting tongue. You know, he says, oh yeah, you brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Now, this is real. John's not just being poetic, right? And then I don't think the church will experience the full wrath of God because, so number one, it's, you know, he says, I come like a thief in the night after the sixth bowl. But then also we've got passages like Romans 5, verse 9. Since therefore we now have been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved by him from the wrath of God? Yeah. 1 Thessalonians 5, 9. God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through our Lord Jesus Christ. There it is again. And another one, 1 Thessalonians 1, verse 10. We wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath to come. I mean, there you go. Straightforward, isn't it? And we've got to camp out here for a minute, though. What are these being poured out? What vessel is it? It's a bowl. Well, a lot of times, you know, we tend to think, you know, we've all had our imaginations corrupted by Indiana Jones. Right? And, you know, remember that old knight Templar that's sitting there guarding all the different chalices? You know, you have chosen wisely. You know, when Andy picks the right one, right? I know, it's such a great line. And so he picks which chalice is the Lord's chalice. If you grab the wrong one, you die. If you grab the right one, you're blessed or whatever, right? I forget the details now, but I'll never forget that. You have chosen wisely. And the guy that died to the Nazi or whatever, he grabbed it. He chose poorly, you know. So, anyway, but there's this room full of really fancy goblets, right? With a long stem and all that. A lot of people in these times drank out of bowls, right? They had a bowl for drinking wine. Now, maybe they were small. I'm not saying they were all drinking like mixing bowls full of wine, you know? But yeah, I'm not going to say. You know, you've seen jokes, right? This giant stem where I only had one glass of wine. It takes like a bottle and a half. Anyway, no, I wonder if these are bowls. And so these are for drinking. This is what I see. When I just based on other, and I'm going to talk you through why I see that. But these are bowls being poured out. Psalm 75, thinking about the wrath of God being poured out of a drinking vessel. Psalm 75, verse 8. And this is being alluded. I mean, Psalm, if you think about it, it's way back in ancient Israel. David is writing these things, you know, and the people that are in his time, most of them, they're writing these. And this is way early in the life of Israel. In the hand of the Lord, there is a cup with foaming wine, well mixed, and he pours out from it. And all the wicked of the earth shall drain it down to the dregs. Every drop. One of the most sobering, you know, I read this recently sort of again, and I it's like I'd read it for the first time just a few years ago in Jeremiah 25. It's terrifying. It's terrifying. He says to Jeremiah in Jeremiah 25, verse 15, thus says the Lord, the God of Israel. The God of Israel said to me, take from my hand this cup of the wine of my wrath and make all the nations to whom I send you drink it. They shall drink and stagger and be crazed because of the sword that I am sending among them. And it goes on and is all the people he's got to give it to. And then in verse 26, all the kings of the earth,
far and near, one after another, and all the kingdoms of the world that are on the face of the earth, and after them the king of Babylon shall drink. That's like, that could be written in Revelation. All the kings of the earth, and then finally the king of Babylon shall drink. Who's the king of Babylon we saw? I think it's Satan. Right? Then you shall say to them, thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel, drink, be drunk and vomit, fall and rise no more because of the sword that I'm sending among you. And if they refuse, I get emotional just thinking, and if they refuse to accept the cup from your hand to drink, then you shall say to them, thus says the Lord of hosts, you must drink. For behold, I begin to work disaster at the city that is called by my name, and shall you go unpunished? You shall not go unpunished, for I am summoning a sword against all the inhabitants of the earth, declares the Lord. I mean, it's just, the Lord has an indictment, verse 31, against the nations. He is entering into judgment with all flesh, and the wicked he will put to the sword. Disaster is going forth from nation to nation, and a great tempest is stirring from the farthest parts of the earth. It's terrifying. It's real. It's intense. It's awful. This is a reality. But then, let's go get some good news now. Isaiah 51. Starting at verse 17. And this is an image of the people of God not drinking the whole cup, not drinking it to the dregs. Wake yourself, stand up, O Jerusalem, you who have drunk from the hand of the Lord the cup of his wrath, who have drunk to the dregs the bowl, the cup of staggering, etc. He says, go to verse 22. Thus says your Lord, the Lord, your God, who pleads the cause of his people, behold, I have taken from your hand the cup of staggering. The bowl of my wrath you shall drink no more. That is the promise of the gospel that would come. Isaiah 53. Just a page or two after that. One flip. 53 verse 4, speaking of the one who would come. Surely he has borne our griefs and carried our sorrows. Yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God and afflicted. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. And with his wounds we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. With that in mind, you can flip forward to Luke 22, verse 42, where Jesus says what in Gethsemane? Father, if you are willing, remove this cup from me. Nevertheless, not my will, but yours be done. He's looking at the cup that was supposed to be given to wicked Jerusalem, and he's drinking it instead. In John 18, Jesus tells Peter, right after he cuts the high priest servant's ear off, he says, put your sword away. He says, shall I not drink the cup that the Father has given me? I mean, just take that in. The full weight of the wrath of God, right? And Jesus takes the cup out of our hand and he drinks it instead. I mean, it's done. What did he say when he gave up the ghost on the cross? Right before he gave up the ghost, he said, it is finished, right? He drank it down to the dregs. He drank it all. And that's in Luke 22:42. But if you go back to Luke 22, verse 20, we see instead another cup being offered to us. Right after he says, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, the cup, after they had eaten, saying, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." So he takes one cup out of our hands and he gives us a different cup. And so whenever I read this now, I hear him say, "This cup," right? He emphasizes this cup, not the other cup. This cup. "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood." Isn't that not powerful when you get all that imagery packed together? He takes one cup out of our hands and he puts a different cup in. Every Sunday, every time you see that cup, don't see something you deserve, right? You have no right to that cup. We have a right, we deserve the other cup. We deserve the bowl of God's wrath. But which bowl does he give us instead? Full of life, full of nourishment, full of the life force of his blood. That's what blood symbolizes, is the life force. So you're drinking in the life of God. And it's kind of a gruesome if you know, the blood and everything. You know, we're not Roman Catholics. We don't think it's actually the physical blood of Jesus, right? But I mean, that's what we're drinking in spiritually. It's the very life of Christ himself. I mean, that's just, I can never get enough of that. So that's all an excursus, but you know, just all this talking about bowls, you know, I got to proclaim the gospel to you, right? Because this completes the picture, right? Let's go on now to the bowls. Notice, I keep shutting my Bible like a tool. I get all dramatic and I close it and I'm like, oh, credit it, mark my page. I mean, it goes pretty quickly. Remember earlier it was, and then the things that were brought down under the earth, it was a quarter of the earth was affected. Remember that? And then with the trumpets, it was a third of the earth that's perfected. Remember the thunders? I speculated maybe there was half or two thirds, but it didn't end up taking place or whatever, for whatever reason. That's mysterious. But now it's everything. Go and pour it on the earth, the seven bowls of the wrath of God. And it's everyone. Every living thing, I think in verse 3, every living thing died that was in the sea. And it's everything, everyone. And, you know, but these affect, it's also very clear. I don't know how to make sense of this, but when it comes to the church being there or not, just to be honest. But if you look at verse 2, the painful sores, right? The first bowl is poured out and it results in harmful and painful sores on the people, but only the people who bore the mark of the beast and worshiped its image, not on the church. So either the church isn't there or the church is spared from this judgment. You know, and so it's everybody that's affected by this. It's a universal judgment, apart from the exceptions it makes explicit. And so remember the four horsemen of the seals, that was primarily focused on the suffering of the church. And this is more like the trumpets. Those were warnings for the non-believing world. Those who are marked by the beast, right? Those were a warning. One third were affected as a warning. But now it's affecting everybody, and they map over very closely. It's like, you know, again, it's like the plagues in Egypt. Very, very reminiscent of the plague, not identical to the plagues, but like the plagues. So the bowl one is painful sores on all who bear the beast's mark. Trumpet one is not like this, but the rest are. Trumpet one, remember, had hail, fire, and blood ruining a third of the land. And so, but this one is sores on our bodies, or their bodies. And I wonder if this just represents just literally like physical suffering of some kind. Yeah, Joda's got a question. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, Emily. That's right, yeah. Yeah, that's good, yeah. But it didn't affect them. Yeah.
Yeah. What were their comments?
I'll tell you in just a minute. Emily's finishing up. So, yeah, no, that's good. I think that's right. It's things like that that make me inclined to think the church is still present on the earth for these. But like the Israelites in Goshen, yeah. That's right, the mark of the beast. Yeah. Yeah, I think so, yeah. So what Joda said was that the sores and all that remind her of Job. And I think that these are reminiscent of the affliction that Job suffered. I've even seen commentators make that connection. So good job, Joda. I called you Jonah, Joda. Okay. All right. I'll leave you alone. And Emily was saying it's like in the plagues in Egypt, the Israelites were in their part of Egypt, where they predominantly lived in the land of Goshen, but they weren't affected by the plagues. The plagues didn't affect them. So when all the rest of Egypt was being struck, you know, in Goshen, they had all their herds were fine and their crops were fine and nobody got the sores and the blood didn't turn, you know, the water didn't turn to blood, all that stuff. Right? They were fine there in that part of Egypt. So it was like this little shaft of light and sanity, like the eye of a hurricane or something, right? In the middle of Egypt. Now everything else is just being torn up, but they're safe where the people of God are. I think that's really, really convincing too for why the church is present but not affected by all these. Yeah. And then, okay, bowl two, the sea is turned to blood like a corpse, not just like fresh blood, but like old blood. It's disgusting. It's awful. Right? And it's just completely corrupted and all living things die. And remember in trumpet two, that the mountain was thrown in the sea and a third of the sea became blood. But now all the sea becomes blood and everything dies. Now we speculated that represented commerce, like international trade, because of the shipping, right? Now it would have to, I guess, affect the internet or something in UPS routes. I don't know what, airports and stuff, right? But it represents these things. Maybe perhaps it represents economic collapse. They're working on it, aren't they, right now? Bunch of corrupt idiots. Globally, it's destroying everything. And so bowl two is a lot like trumpet two. Bowl three is a lot like trumpet three because that's the ruining of all the fresh water. And fresh water being, you know, required for life. And, you know, so we speculated there it was wormwood. It turned the water bitter. It didn't turn it to blood. But here it's the fresh water is turning to blood as well. And notice too here, who cries out in verse 7? I heard the altar saying, "Yes, Lord God the Almighty, true and just are your judgments." You remember who was calling out for vindication? Yeah, the martyrs, the saints under the altar. And now it's like their voice is calling out from the altar saying, "You go, God, yeah." Right? You're doing it. So it's like the satisfaction of their hopes and their ambition. They're delighted to see God doing this. So the altar is talking. I would think it would probably those martyrs calling out. That's a shorthand for that. You know, again, what that means exactly, the fresh water turning foul into blood, I don't know exactly. I mean, it could be, but this is, yeah, they've been given blood to drink. I don't think it's the martyr's blood they're drinking. I think it's foul wrath of God they're drinking. I don't know, maybe it's, so they've shed blood, they get blood, right? Of a different kind, maybe. I'm open to being wrong about that, but that's my hunch. Yeah. Maybe that's some kind of cultic ritual, though, right? Drinking the blood of people they've sacrificed or whatever, right? Murdered. So bowl 5, starting at verse 10. Oh, I skipped 4, huh?
Four.
Oh, I'm sorry. You're right. I did skip 4. So the sun scorches people and with fire. And nobody repents, even though all this is happening. They just curse God, and they do not repent and give him glory. It's remarkable. Like all this, it's like the suffering and the pain can end. Just give God the glory. Just turn and say, I was wrong. And I do want to know you. That's all it is. But they persist. They're like, never, you know. We've all dug our heels in and said never about something. So let's not be too hard on them, right? But, you know, and that's a lot like trumpet 4, where the sun, the heavens were struck, you know, the stars and the moon, and a third of them were darkened, right? Remember that? That was the fourth trumpet, now the fourth bowl. It's like the sun is like scorching them. So I don't know what this means. Maybe it means severe famine. Maybe some kind of spiritual or psychological judgment. Maybe they'll sort of lose their minds a little bit or something. I don't know. But it seems like I don't know. It's the fact that they're defiant, you know, and their hearts are hardened even further, like we saw in the sixth trumpet before. They don't turn from their ways and all this. They just double down. You know, I don't know. Maybe the sun scorching them like sears their conscience or something, and just like cauterizes their spiritual feeling or something. You know, I don't know. But their obstinance there and their persistence in it. And the refusal to repent and to turn to God for light and love and life and protection and all that is remarkable. And then, all right, bowl 5. Now the authority of the beast is affected. And they're plunged into darkness. And this is like trumpet 5, when a star fell to the earth and darkness, and then it opened up the pit. You know, all these evil things came out. You know, dark forces and all that came out to afflict us, to afflict non-believers anyway. And so here they're suffering under it. And the kingdom is plunged into darkness, and people gnawed their tongues in anguish and cursed the God of heaven for their pain and their sores. They did not repent of their deeds, so they're still persisting. I wonder if, you know, there are sort of two levels of grace that we understand. One is the grace that we think of when we think about grace, which is the gospel, the good news, and the Holy Spirit who brings us and unites us to Christ and saves us. That's special grace, like special revelation. But there's also general grace in that the rain falls on the just and the unjust alike. And we see this in Noah's, in the covenant with Noah, where the seasons are regular and the sea stops at a certain point. And in spite of what global warming alarmists might say, the sea is not going to rise any farther than God wants it to. And so there's this sense in which, you know, earth will still produce fruit and crops. And that's why, you know, non-believers and believers alike can be farmers and reap a harvest and enjoy the fruits of the earth and all that. It's God's common grace that he gives to everybody, right? So I wonder if this darkening of everything, everybody under the, so you, again, you can see the land of Goshen is a helpful example to keep in mind. You know, you got darkness over the land of Egypt, but there's sunshine in Goshen where the Israelites are, right? So I wonder if this is the removal of the larger measure of God's common grace. Like, if you think the world is bad now, how bad do you think it would be if God were not restraining evil? Like, this is God restraining evil. If he were to remove his hand, protecting us from ourselves, you know, the entire earth would be engulfed in murder and bloodshed and treachery like we couldn't even imagine. The fact that the world is, a lot of times people say, oh, the world is so evil, there must not be a good God in heaven, because if he were good or if he were all powerful, he wouldn't let any of this stuff happen. It's like you're looking at it from the wrong point of view. You should be surprised that it's not worse, that worse things aren't happening, given the devastation of sin and how awful we can be. So we need to fix our perspective a little bit and not insist on having it better, when actually we have it way better than we should, than we deserve, even with all of our problems and trials and pain and difficulty and suffering. None of us deserve to exist, you know what I mean? None of us deserve a meal. None of us deserve a breath. But he gives it anyway to everybody. And he's patient with them, giving everybody that, you know, time to repent and turn to him, you know. And so I wonder if this is the removal of common grace, and they're just in the world, that the world order just begins to crumble under the weight of sin and corruption. And this is why they're just cursing God. And just, I deserve better, you know, kind of thing. They're shaking in their fists at heaven. That's the best sense I can make of that bowl of wrath, of being plunged into darkness. And then bowl six, you know, this is the one where the dragon and the beasts are allowed to make war and assemble the kings of the earth at Armageddon for the final battle. And in trumpet six, remember, a third of mankind was killed by the four dark angels that were bound at the Euphrates. Remember that? So it seems like they weren't heavenly angels, but they were dark angels being kept until they were to be released for destruction and war, right? I think this is from a different, using different imagery, the same thing, but just full scale, not a third now being killed, but everybody being caught up in war. And so the Euphrates is dried up. It has to do with, I think, a similar image to the Euphrates, those angels being bound at the Euphrates back in the trumpet. But now the Euphrates is dried up. It's no more. The restriction is released. And now all the evil of Babylon is unleashed. And they gather the forces of the world together to wage war on God. It's like one final push. And we'll see how this relates as we could do other visions. So we'll see in, like, I think it's 19 or 20, where it's in 20, where Satan, where the beast, the dragon, has sort of like a last hurrah, where he's allowed to wage war and do all these things, right? I think that's what this is talking about here. And so they're all gathering, and it's like Psalm 2 is coming alive, you know, verses 1 through 2. You know, the kings of the earth and all this, they wage war. Let me see. Can't resist. I love Psalm 2 so much.
Father Jeremy, is this a period of time when God's leash on Satan was released?
I wouldn't say released, but I would say he's given a lot more slack than he had before. Yeah? Yeah, God sort of lets him have his head for a brief moment, and he just goes for it. And maybe he thinks, oh, finally, I'm going to win. You know what I mean? Psalm 2, verses 1 and 2. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against his anointed, saying, let us burst their bonds apart and cast away their cords from us. The prophecy, I think, about the end times. And now this is what they always want to do, and now they're being allowed to do it for a little bit. And so, interestingly, Armageddon is actually a place that you can go visit today. It's from the Hebrew sort of Har Megiddo. There's a city called Megiddo, and Har just means mountain. Or it could be not Har, but maybe Ir Megiddo, just means city, right, Emily? Yeah, Ir, the city. You know that I am, Hebrew jokes. And it's this very ancient city in northern Israel, sort of on Galilee, not too far from Nazareth, up there in the northern part of Israel, above the West Bank in today's geography. And lots of battles happened there. And this was a big crossroads for international trade. So for like all the merchants from Mesopotamia and all the merchants from Egypt would go through there to go to like Asia Minor and then a bit of Europe. And so the flow is going right through there. And that was a main highway. So it's a crossroads for all the nations. And so it seems like they all meet there and they gather and gather up their forces to oppose God for one last go. This is like Satan's last attempt, final chance as claiming the throne of heaven, you know, and being released from his exile to the earth. He sees this. I'm going to gather all these forces. I'm going to go for it. And so there's another story that's really interesting. There are battles that happened there in the Old Testament too. Like that's where Josiah, King Josiah of Judah, died at the hand of Pharaoh, Necho. And, you know, late in Judah's life. And there's another story way back in Judges 4 and 5. The Judges 4 and 5, and the judge is a woman named Deborah. And it seems like her general, or maybe her partner judge, her co-judge, is this guy Barak, not Obama, but a different Barak. And it's Deborah and sort of the leader of the forces, Barak, versus the Canaanite king Jabin and his general Sisera. And they'd been oppressing Israel for 20 years. And they had all this really high grade for that time military technology and weaponry. They had like iron chariots, which would have been, I think, insanely expensive for back then and difficult to pull off because iron was very rare. Right? We're just coming out of the Bronze Age, sort of, you know? And so they got iron chariots and they'd oppressed Israel with their weaponry for like 20 years. And then, but Deborah, a woman of faith, and Barak, he follows the lead of her faith. And they go and they destroy, and the Lord completely destroys the opposing forces. And so it's interesting, you've got this woman, and then God destroys the people. I wonder if Deborah is like a very early image of the church or something, you know? Like the woman we saw prophesied, you know, she sort of participates in with Eve and Mary and all the rest. So Deborah is there summing up Israel and putting her faith in God. And then God comes and destroys them. He completely wipes them out in a supernatural way. That's a pretty cool way to think about Armageddon, right? It's a good story. So a lot of people think that this is an allusion to that, or that battle between Deborah and Barak and then the king of the Canaanites and all that, Jabin, and everything is foreshadowing Armageddon. And is, but it takes place at Megiddo, Ir Megiddo. Isn't that cool? That's really fun. So, and we get more details on all this by Revelation 19. And guess what? We're almost finished. All right. Bowl 7. I shut my Bible again, but I marked it this time. Bowl 7, starting at verse 17, going to the end, 21. You get this loud voice coming from the temple. It is done. I don't think it's the same in the Greek as what Jesus said on the cross. It is finished. But it has the same sense about it, right? It's a sense of God is proclaiming something is completed. And so it's just, this is it. This is, he's tying a bow on the whole thing. And there were flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, earthquake, and heavy hail. Well, that sounds really familiar because back in Trumpets 7, when victory and praise was being proclaimed by the 24 elders and the ark was seen, what was seen there? What was then experienced as the heavens opened up and you saw directly to the throne of God? Flashes of lightning, rumblings, peals of thunder, earthquake, and heavy hail. It's the same things. So these previous ones, it's like a refrain that keeps going through these visions, assigned to the very end and the final judgment. lightning, rumbling, thunder, earthquake, and hail. And the earth is quite literally in every way destroyed. Can you imagine 100-pound hailstones? Just coming down, just blanketing the earth and just smothering, you know, it would be unequal devastation, a great earthquake, such that there had never been since man was on the earth so great. It's like the earth is just shaking and shattering at its core, right? And then the heavens are just raining down this blanket of cannonballs from way up high. Think of the velocity, you know, of a hailstone. You know, a little grape-sized one, what it can do to your car, right? 100-pound coming down. And God remembered Babylon the Great to make her drain the cup of wine of the fury of his wrath. You must drink. Way back to Jeremiah, it's coming true here. They drained the cup of the wine of the fury of his wrath. And every island fled away. No mountains were to be found. And great hailstones, about 100 pounds each, fell from heaven on people. And they cursed God for the plague of the hail because the plague was so severe. I mean, this is lights out for the whole world, you know. And thanks be to God, we had that image of them, of the church, standing beside the sea, singing the song of Moses, right? But this is what's in store for those who have the mark of the beast, who belong to him. And if you remember back in the second vision, in the sixth seal, this is in chapter 6, 16 and 17, all humanity that's left, the rich and the poor and the great and the small and everybody, right? They're all calling out to the mountains and the rocks to shield them from the wrath of the Lamb, right? The wrath of God. And here, there are no mountains. There are no islands. There's nowhere to hide. There's nowhere to go. There's nothing to cover you and protect you from it. It's just absolute devastation. And that's the end of the section. We did it. Now, thanks be to God, there's more to the book of Revelation than that, huh? Yeah, Felix has got a question. Yeah.
So I want to clear something because some of the bowls.
Yeah.
It sounds like you have a literal interpretation of something.
Right. Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Like scorching, you don't think it's happening.
It could be. Okay. Yeah. Okay. I'm just trying to think. I don't want to be overly literal and miss a really helpful application, you know? And ways to do it. It could be literal, yeah. It could be a scorching heat, but I mean, if he scorches everybody completely with the sun, there's nothing left to burn for the hailstones to crush, you know? So just think about the logistics of it. It's going to be both. It's going to be, that's a helpful comment. Question. Felix was saying, so do we interpret all this literally, or is it all spiritually, symbolic, or allegorical, whatever? And I'm saying yes. I think not everything will necessarily be physical in these. Sometimes I think it is symbolic. But it will also involve the physical world too. And it will be, the destruction will be complete in devastation. That's a really good comment. Any other thoughts or questions? Yeah, Joda. Jonah's making a connection maybe between the earthquake that happened after Christ's death when the earth shook and the curtain was torn in two and all that. No, I don't think so. But just earthquakes have this general sense of judgment and wrath, right? And so, yeah, that would have been like maybe one of the trumpets or something, like a, you know, a warning shock, a four tremor or four shock to the big one, you know? That's good. Mike, who else? Michael, yeah. The trumpets, well, that's good. He's trying to make sense of the seven trumpets and the seven bowls. The seven trumpets only involved a third of the earth affected. So not everybody was struck by these in the trumpets. And it's thought that, and I think it's probably right, that those were warnings. So let's say there's three people, right, standing. and one person dies for some reason because you're doing something stupid, right? Let's say you're touching like an electric fence or something, right? Your buddy touches it and he dies. The other two of you are going to back way off, right? Like, oh my goodness, yeah, I'm going to learn from that idiot's mistake, right? So I think these are warning shocks, right? Everybody deserves judgment to be destroyed at any time. Like the fact that we exist still is God's mercy, okay? And so for them, the final judgment comes a little early in the trumpets. But for the sake of warning the rest of the earth. So trumpets, you just think of it like literally a trumpet calls out and makes a noise to get your attention. Or whatever it is, right? You got my attention, right? And then somebody dies, you're like, whoa, I better turn to God and repent, right? Because judgment day came early for them and it's going to come anytime for me. So I better turn to God. That's the opportunity that's presented to people. Whereas the bowls of wrath are the actual final judgment itself. So the first are like a warning tremor, a warning of bad things to come. I think so. Yeah, that's the point we made before. Michael asked if the trumpets have been going on since the fall. I think they have. These kinds of things that we're afflicted by spiritually, the human race, and even the physical stuff that we suffer, disease and all this stuff, right? And natural disasters and economic woes and all that, right? But the fact that everything doesn't just completely unravel and be destroyed, the God sustains it by his mercy. So there are some destruction and some hardship, but not complete and total yet. But they're all to get our attention. And so that we'll be realizing that there is a final reckoning coming. And so that we will be prepared for it. And so a big part of this is remember to help the church understand the signs of the times and to see, to be alert and awake and to persevere with endurance so that they won't be naive. They'll understand that, remember this, the apocalypse is this uncovering of secret things, right? And so he's showing us these things, Jesus is through John, so that we'll understand the spiritual realities behind the world in which we live. Because again, remember, we're all materialists. We're born materialists. We only focus on the stuff in front of us and the things we can see. And we're all empiricists, right? We can taste, touch, see, smell, and feel and all that with our senses. Those are the things we think are important and real. The spiritual stuff, it's just kind of out there. We've got it upside down. The spiritual stuff is more real and more longer lasting and more enduring than the physical stuff, right? An angel in heaven that is around the throne of God is more substantial and powerful and enduring than my own body. I just can't see it, so I don't appreciate that reality, you know? So that's why we have to live in the world of the Bible with our heads and our hearts and operate by faith, not with our eyes, but with the eyes of faith, with the eyes of our heart and our mind, according to the Word of God. What the Word of God allows us to see, that which we cannot see for ourselves. That's why we need revelation. Again, getting back to general versus special. General revelation is I go out on the ocean, or I'm fishing on the lake at 7 a.m. or something or whatever, and I'm like, there must be a God. This is so beautiful. You know, you've all felt that. You're at the beach or in the mountains or something. This is just amazing. You're looking at the stars at night. There must be a God. How powerful is he? You know, all this, and how good is he to make something so beautiful and cool, you know? That's general revelation that everybody can see and appreciate. Most of humanity, unless they're psychopaths, have had thoughts like that. Right? That's general revelation, available and accessible to every human being on earth. Special revelation is like the creed, right? That Jesus, that the Son of God was born of a Virgin Mary. He suffered and died under Pontius Pilate, you know, and all this kind of stuff, right? And he rose again. The particularities of the Christian faith and the particularity, the revelation of the gospel is something else altogether. You cannot be saved out on the golf course just admiring God's handiwork. You're admiring God's handiwork and you're giving him sort of a crude sense of praise, and that's good in its own way, but it doesn't save anybody. Only the special revelation, only when we trust in Jesus Christ and what God has done to reconcile us to himself through the blood of Jesus, and the working of the Holy Spirit, making us one with Christ, giving his mark across our spiritual forehead, saying, holy unto the Lord. That is how we're saved, is through faith in the special revelation. Because let's face it, people will go hunting or out on the beach or in the mountains or whatever. They'll admire God's creation. They'll give thanks to God, and then they'll go off and do wicked things, right? They'll go home and they'll fight with their spouse. They'll call people awful names. They'll rob somebody. They'll cheat on their taxes. They'll even maybe kill somebody, or, you know what I mean? They'll do whatever. So there's this schizophrenia, you know, that we have. But really, it's only special revelation that gets it done. So, yeah. Any other comments or questions before we wrap up? We actually got through it, huh? That's good. All right, so read next time the sixth vision, the woman of Babylon, the harlot, the prostitute or whatever, and the beast are destroyed in chapter 17 through 19, so three chapters for next time. All right, that's it. Let's pray. Oh, Heavenly Father, once again, we thank you for the mercy of being able to see and understand these things to a certain degree. Never will we be able to exhaust these things in this life, but we thank you for the insight and understanding you have given us. Now we pray for more. I pray, Lord, that we would respect these realities and these things that you've shown to us in your word. You didn't have to show it, but you did, and you are good. And so give us, like what we've been praying with John and with your words to us through John, give us endurance, give us a sobriety and a certain seriousness, and feel the weight of these things, to know that these things do matter, that they have eternal consequence, and this is life or death. Give us the seriousness, Lord, and give us just grateful hearts for those of us that trust in you and have received your love and received your mark on our foreheads. Keep us always, Lord, and we thank you for your faithfulness. We're so glad this doesn't depend on our faithfulness, because if we could leave you, we would. But you never leave us. You stick closer than a brother, and we love you for it. We ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, God bless you all, and we will see you. See you soon.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Good night.
Good night.
God bless.